Good morning, church. Welcome back to online service. We're glad that you could join us this week. We want you to know that we love you, we're praying for you, and we want you to join in worship with us.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's rule as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He hears faith. There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's rule as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear worship. He hears faith. Awake my soul and sing, sing his praise aloud, sing his praise aloud.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for tuning in to KTF Church on YouTube. We appreciate you so much. We have a website, Key to Faith Church website, ktfm.org, I believe it is, keytofaithministries.org. Please go there. We are at the Fox Hollow Inn every other week. If you would like to join us, we appreciate your patronage. We appreciate your support. We're going through the book of 1 Peter. I have a couple of cool things in mind for July. It's called, I believe it's called Getting back to basics, 10 immutable things God wants you to know. We're probably going to work on that a little bit, trying to get that out to you. Very, very exciting. I'm excited about what's ahead for us. I'm excited of what God's doing. The pandemic is almost over. We could go outside soon. We could see each other's smiles. No more masks. I just thank God that God is so merciful to us. And so again, thank you for support. Thank you for tuning in. We appreciate you. We know that we all need ministry. We all need to hear the word. We all need to hear preaching, which is encouragement, strength, truth. Oh my goodness, it is such a useful thing. And so so last week I talked in about 1 Peter 3:2-10 about watching our speech and cancel culture and how we are rude and crude and mean to one another, and God wants us to change our manner of speech. But before we change our manner of speech, I guess we have to change our heart. We have to see that at one time we were in that place in darkness, in defeat, in weakness, where we felt that we had to retaliate, that we felt that we had to say something back, that we had to insult twice as hard as someone insulted us, or we had to protect our ego or our fragileness, or we did not have confidence or self-control. There's a lot of people who think or seem like they have confidence and self-control because they might be quick on their feet and know how to be really mean back twice as hard. But that's not the kingdom of God. That's not the culture that God wants to create, not in the church and not the church outside in the world reflecting the nature of Jesus Christ. So we're going to read this passage of scripture quick, and I just want to expand on some of the things that I did last week. I just think it's important to do that. Finally, all of you should be of one mind. One mind, all of one mind. What is that mind? To be in communion and union with God's thoughts. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. What does that mean? The Word just means the thoughts of God, the communication of God. Jesus was the Word. He embodied the communication and the thoughts and the mind and the will and the heart of God. He embodied it, so he spoke it. So we're being of one mind. In other words, we're uniting ourselves to God. We're uniting ourselves to the heart of God, to the mind of God, you know, to the will of God. John 17, Jesus prayed that they may be one in us even as we are one. That's a very powerful thing. That kind of union, to have the mind and heart of God flow through you, that when outside pressure comes, you do not succumb by becoming evil, becoming like the culture. It's a very, very powerful thing to have the strength of God in us. You know, Jesus said, when they persecute you, your Father will give you the words to speak. And I don't believe that Jesus spoke harsh words. Jesus spoke truth to power. But I don't think he said it to be harsh or to be cruel. I think he said it sometimes to help people to see that what they're doing is just so bad for themselves and other people. Look, I'm a dad and I'm a grandpa, and there are sometimes I had to correct my children because it was so their thoughts, their words, the things that they were doing was so destructive, self-destructive, that I wanted to save them from the course that they were going on. Nobody wants to speak truth in a way that hurts somebody, but we have to speak truth in a way that saves somebody. And I believe that's what Jesus did. So he said, be of one mind. We're trying to bring people, this is God's mind. This is what God says. This is what God thinks. This is God's way. Do you see it? I want your mind to be in union with God's mind. It's very beautiful. Sympathize with each other. Love each other as brothers and sisters. Be tender-hearted. Keep a humble attitude. Humility seems to be absent. Oh my goodness, it's just so absent in our culture. But all you got to do is have one big thing happen. But it seems like no one gets embarrassed anymore. It seems like as the moral standards decrease, humility decreases, you know, because we just justify everything. Or we promote it as the right way because It's the only way to get strength against truth. And we don't want to ever show strength against truth. No, that's what humility is. It's showing strength for the truth by humbling ourselves. Very powerful. Don't repay evil for evil. Big point. Massive point. We talked about that last week. I won't go over it again. Don't retaliate with insults when people insult you, and don't pay them back with anything but a blessing. That is what God called you to do, and God will grant you a blessing. For the scripture says, if you want to enjoy life, see happy days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. So we don't want to speak evil or tell lies. And we all have a position to protect, you know, so we're going to speak evil, you know, we're going to attack the attacker in order to defeat them, and even if it takes lies. And it's like the cat chasing its tail. We are in this terrible circle where where all this emotional wreckage is taking place, because we are so afraid to say I'm wrong, or I have to change this, or I need humility, or I have to do the right thing. It's so hard for people to submit to a higher authority. That's why people don't want to believe in God today. That's why they want to reject God today. They don't want to hear there's a standard, there's a way of doing things, there's good and evil and wrong and right, because then we're like singled out. We have to look at ourselves. We have to look at those shortcomings. We have to conquer them. It's so easy to give in, rather than to stand up and to do the right thing. That's what courage is. Courage is to stand up and do the right thing, even if it's not always profitable. I mean, we just read this. God said, if you don't return evil for evil, I'm going to bless you. I will take care of it. No matter what they do, you leave them to me, I'm going to take care of you. Big point, but it's so big. Doesn't matter what they do to you, I'm going to take care of you and I'll take care of them. No one gets away with anything. You've heard me preach this several times. It's a big point. It's a big thing. It's something to think about. You don't have to retaliate. You don't have to be evil. You don't have to do evil. You don't have to get back. You don't have to render evil for evil. God's going to take care of it. You just keep doing the right thing. His ears are open to the righteous. We're going to read it in a minute. His heart is open to those who are following him and will do right. It's a good thing. The eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right, and his ears open to their prayers. I don't know about you, but prayer is a big part of my life. I need God to hear my prayers. I don't know about you, but there is evil in the world, and at times it comes to oppress me. And the reason why Jesus came is to break the oppression of evil over me, over you in this world. Jesus said in Luke 4:18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He came to heal the brokenhearted, open the prison door, recovery of sight to the blind, to speak the good news to the poor in spirit, and to break the oppression of the oppressors. So, you know, like oppression will come through people, but people are driven by demonic powers and evil spirits. People are driven by foolish motives and evil motives that are in their own heart. Our own nature is fallen. So, you know, we have to be very, very careful that we are not following the wrong spirit or having the wrong heart or attitude towards other people. Our attitude towards them should be forgiving and loving. We're always moving to build, not to tear down. And that's the job of the church. God wants to build. He doesn't want to tear down. He said, upon this rock that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, I will build my church. And the gates of hell, evil, will not prevail against it. The gates of hell will not withstand. Evil will not withstand the coming kingdom. It is coming. The Bible said there'll be a day where they'll be wailing because people were sorry they didn't see it, or gnashing of teeth because they're still trying to oppose it. But our job is to come. There's an invitation right now. Come, come. I'll heal you. I'll change you. I'll bless you. I'll open your eyes. I'll open your heart. I'll show you the good and great things that God has for you. Jesus preached the kingdom is present. The kingdom is at hand. You can receive it. All your transgressions against the kingdom and the kingdom of God, I am going to the cross. I'm going to forgive you. I'm going to give you entrance. I'm going to give you protection. I'm going to give you more than a temporary lease on life that may go from 0 to 100 years old, whatever you want, but that's it. I'm going to give you an eternal perspective. I'm inviting you into something eternal. I'm inviting you into something that is much more than this life, what you'll eat, you'll drink, you'll wear, how much money you made, but actually a kingdom of such moral power, such moral love, such goodness towards God and God towards us and towards one another, that it will reap eternal happiness. It is more than what you possess. We possess what we possess because we have the character to keep it and not destroy it. We possess what we possess because we have the character to keep it and not destroy it, not destroy our lives. You know, we make possessions more important than our character. We make achievements more important than our character. And so, you know, our country is always seeking achievements, but you know what? You know, science is neutral. I mean, we can use science to make an A-bomb and kill a million people. We can make science to heal a pandemic. How wonderful is that? But science is amoral. It's up to the character of the science and the scientists, and I pray they know the will of God. Because we have to know how to use these creative gifts that God gave us to change the world, to heal the world, not to destroy it. So it's so very important, you know. But the Lord turns his face against those who do evil. So 1 Peter 3:8, 10, and 12. I just want to talk about some things. Finding the strength to love in the midst of all of our shortcomings and even in times of persecution. If there's anyone that's a magnificent example of this, it was Jesus. I mean, just the hate that came against him because he told the truth. I mean, the hate was so great that it eventually ended in violence, and that violence ended in his death. The thing is that his death was predestined before the foundation of the world, and that his death would pay for the sins of humanity and free them from the judgment and the consequence of God, because God's going to deal with evil. We may not like it. We may not want to hear it. We may reject it as truth, but God will. And so God even found strength in speaking the truth to those who just hated Jesus, were in opposition to him. You know, people are going to be in opposition to you. I believe part of the work of the community of the church is to find strength to love one another, to love our neighbor next door to us who may disagree with us. We have to love people we disagree with. It is an awful thing not to love people that don't agree with you. I mean, that's part of the strength of being a good Christian, is we love the people who are in opposition to themselves, their best interest, because they don't know any better. The Bible said their minds have been darkened. But thank God Jesus is the light of the world. And Jesus said, then the truth will set you free. It's beautiful. So finding strength to love in the midst of all our shortcomings, that's going to be the thing. The heavier the pressure, the persecution, the more we have to find strength to love other people. Not becoming like the culture around us that's cruel, unkind, ungodly. That's going to be the battle that I think we're going to be facing in the next 10 years. Okay, so, you know, when we preach this gospel, it is because we're talking about eternity. We are not talking about 50 to 75 to 150 years. I mean, we're all trying so much to extend our lifespan. Telomeres and all these medicines that they want to give you, and they want to hook up your computer to a brain, download it into a half human, half, I mean, it is not going to solve the immorality of the soul, the brokenness of the soul. You're still going to be you with all of its pain and suffering and heartache and troubles, and eventually, you know, someone's just going to destroy the machine that you're in. It's not about that. It's not extending the length of your life. It's extending the truth of your life. How you live is more important than the tent you live in, the machine that you live in. We are a spirit living in a body. Already you're in a sense you're synthetic, but when heaven separated from earth, this body became mortal. You are not always mortal, you know. And the time is coming where the body that God gives you will be immortal again. That was God's original intent. You can't overturn God's plan and God's will. He's going to do it. He's going to give you back an immortal body. But until that time comes, until that time comes, we have to remember that our time here is so limited. Remember that God granted you eternal life. That's the thing. If you sin forever. If you become a Christian, you're a Christian forever. And you get to choose whether you want to live in God's presence or not. I hear all this debate about God sending people to hell. No, God doesn't send anybody to hell. You choose where you want to go. If you hate God so bad and you don't like anything about his character or his nature, you're just going to go someplace where his character and his nature doesn't exist because that's your choice. I mean, we love to just blame God for everything, but it's never God's fault because God has done everything that he can do. You know, there's a saying, he pulled out all the stops. There is nothing to stop you from coming to God and living eternally in his presence, in bliss, and everything you'll ever desire and ever need will be satisfied. I love the word sympathy there. To sympathize means to help those who are suffering, knowing in humility that one day you may need help. I mean, we're so busy trying to get back to get even, you know, that I don't see real compassion or sympathy for people. You know, our country is focusing on retaliation, and that is never going to heal a country. It never will heal a family. It will never heal a broken friendship, a broken relationship between a husband and wife, between parents and children. Retaliation is just blowing your life up. I mean, if the end of the world comes, it's going to come through some kind of jealous retaliation. You know, it's so amazing how so much what people think is good is really a false humility. It's really just getting even. It's not really justice. It's not doing good. It's not being an example. It is getting back. It is getting your due. I mean, there's so much false compassion out there, you know, not requiring people to step up and take responsibility for their lives or what's wrong or what's right, what's good and what's evil, what's beneficial for everyone. We've just gotten into a place where we are not allowing ourselves to do the right thing anymore. We are standing, even if something is wrong, we are continuing to do it. We think it's a sign of strength. And in fact, the more broken people are, we're standing up for them. That is not a compassionate thing to do. There's so much false compassion. As I look at the people that are coming through the border of our country, they are not being assimilated into the American dream. They're being used and abused by drug dealers, by coyotes. If they would get online and legally come in, how much more beautiful would it be? They can have that problem. They say, well, the oppression there, that's so terrible. But the oppression that they're going through to get here can be almost as awful. And it seems like such compassion, but it's not compassion. You know, the law is compassionate. The law brings equality. There are people waiting online that did not get in because they were faithful to wait online and others jumped the line. I don't know how much you would like it, but it's just another injustice. How many, we can't solve all the injustices in the world. You know, one of the great things about having a country is that it has an ethos, it has an ethic, it has an ideal, it has a purpose, it has a plan. You know, when the immigration is just too much, you know what happens? That country loses its identity. And it's great to be a melting pot. That's one of the greatest things about our countries. But it says, e pluribus unum, out of many, one. We are losing our cohesion. We're losing our oneness. And we're letting nations like communist China and certain other nations whose cohesion is by force and cruelty. Our cohesion is by accepting other people, by helping other people. But in the meantime, we have to be careful that we don't get overwhelmed. You know, there's only so much taxes that we can pay to help other people where we ourselves become bankrupt. And now the purpose of the country is lost. It's the same thing with culture. As it tries to inundate the church, it becomes too much, and the church gets watered down, and the purpose of the church gets watered down, and the truth of the church gets watered down. Before you know it, the church becomes like the world. We don't want the nation to become like other nations, and just as much we don't want the church to become like the world. So we are to have sympathy, but we have to be so careful about false compassion, you know, helping people by sympathizing with their plight while they do the wrong thing. I guess I should have just simplified it, but that was just a good example. My heart breaks for the people in many nations who are suffering under so many things, you know, but there's only so many people that we can help, you know. And we have to be so careful not to be overwhelmed in our personal walk with God. You know, we are in the world, but not of it. And as the pressure comes to be less like Jesus, we're going to face this overwhelming thing. So be sympathetic. Be sympathetic, but be sympathetic in a godly way, in a way that's in accordance with God's will. You know, we want to sympathize with everyone's place or weakness or proclivity, whatever, and instead we're not helping them. We're allowing them to destroy themselves. We are allowing them to come to a place where we're really not helping them at all. They're going from the frying pan, you know, to the fire. We really need to help people. So the word sympathy is so misused in our culture today. So many things are seen as compassionate when they're really contrary to the will of God. And it's such, I guess some people would call it virtue signaling. We have to be so careful that we're staying in accordance with the will of God. Laws protect. And, you know, we want to protect the citizens by those laws. And the kingdom of God protects, and we have to protect ourselves by doing the right thing. And you know what? Even the church sometimes becomes like the world because we want to be so accepting of people that they come, but we don't expect change. And that's such a negative thing. Jesus said, go into all the world making disciples of the nations. He didn't say, let them come in and keep their false ideas and religions and truths, make disciples, make them followers of Jesus Christ. So it's so powerful. This false sympathy is just ruining our country because we're making sympathy greater than the truth. No, the greatest truth you can have is to get people to change. They're fleeing from a country that has so many problems, and they can bring that with them. And then it's no longer the United States, and it's no longer the church. When you enter the church, you're almost making a commitment to change, to be moved to the will of God, you know? And so much false sympathy for people that are in different kinds of sins and proclivities. We're just saying, it's okay, we accept you, we love you. We do accept you and we do love you. But like us, we need change. We need the power of change. We need to have the power of the will of God strengthen and encourage us and bring us to a place where we can obey God, where we can put a morality in our lives and in our churches and in our country that's going to overcome evil. You know, everything is about overcoming, being made strong. And we need that. Sometimes it's the sympathy of others, but not by just agreeing with everything that's wrong and saying that it's compassion. It's a big problem in our country right now. We are just allowing a false sense of compassion, devoid of truth, to be spoken over people's lives where we just will accept almost anything. And what we're really doing is over time we're slowly degrading the truths that make us great. And that's why the church is such a powerful institution. The years and years of history, you know, recorded what God said over the centuries. It's never changed. There's a cohesiveness to it. How do you go through centuries and nations and people? It's like people say, I can't believe the Bible was written by men. It's like the telephone. No, I mean, the same thing they said 10,000 years ago, we're still reading in our Bibles 10,000 years later. There's a cohesiveness to it. There's a constant thread of God's will that just is immutable, unchangeable against civilizations and cultures that opposed it. And yet it still exists, it's still strong, and it will exist until the end of the age. But it's so powerful, you know. Many times the nation of Israel fell because it sympathized with people who accepted certain things that were bad as good. And it calling good evil and evil good. God warns us against that. So there's so much sympathy. I'm sorry that I'm just extending this, but there is this guise, this false compassion that is out there that's very destructive to our nation. And I say that because it's destructive to the church. And the church is in the nation, and the church's job is to help save. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. It's not that we're against immigration or immigrants. My grandparents were immigrants, or that we don't want to help people in their situations. Obviously we do. But in the meantime, we have to keep the strength of our culture. We have to keep the strength of our community of faith. We have to adhere to the truth. We have to adhere to the principles of the Constitution. We just say everybody, oh, we're going to change it because things are different. No, what works, what's right is right. What's true is true. You don't change your foundation. The Bible said if the foundations be destroyed, what will the righteous do? And that's what we're doing. We're trying to accommodate people, and we're destroying the foundations. No, keep the foundations, keep the laws, keep the will of God, keep the things that are good. It's good to have sympathy. It's good to have compassion. It's good to remember you're so blessed to be here. You won the lottery to be born in this country. You won the greatest lottery to receive eternal life. You know, and you know what? It's we're never going to solve all the injustices in the world that are here because so many people oppose the kingdom of God. But in the meantime, let's not be a people without compassion and without humility. No, but humility knows what we have received because of what we learned, those foundations. That's what humility is. What made us great, we're turning from and calling compassion. It is a very powerful weapon of the enemy to accuse you of being an uncompassionate or incompassionate. I'm not really sure how to say that. But lacking compassion, not being a good person, and it's very, very dangerous because we are allowing the standards that make us great, that make real compassion a reality. And it is so good. You know, to remember, don't let anybody begin to accuse you of being unsympathetic or unkind because you adhere to principles that make us all better human beings, better countrymen, better church people, better followers of Christ. Don't ever go down there. So rendering evil for evil is not justice. It just inflames the circumstance. Anyway, I think I said it, enough about that. It's a little bit of a difficult, you know, subject. Maybe some people may object to the, you know, to the illustration that I use, but it is helpful regardless of what you believe. It is an helpful illustration, you know, that there is a false compassion and a false sympathy that's overtaking us, and we must be very careful not to allow it to corrupt our standards and the truths that we know to be true that make us who we are, and that make this country what it is, that makes Christianity what it is. So very powerful. I'd like to pray with you. Perhaps you are feeling maybe offended. Maybe you are feeling saddened. Maybe you are feeling challenged. Maybe you are feeling that you're not accepted. But I want you to know that we love you, that we do accept you, and that, you know, the greatest path is the one that will where we face ourselves, where we stand before God and we ask God, what is wrong, what is right, and change me. You know, the whole Old Testament is filled, and even the New Testament faces the challenge of other gods. And those other gods is really making something, a God out of what we agree with, not of who God says that he is. And so we're not changed. We're trying to change God, and the Bible calls it idolatry, you know. Listen, we want to be changed. We want We want to become better. We want the will of God. It is what will make us whole, our nation better, our lives better, our families better, our children better, our communities better, our friendships better, our marriages better. Everything will be bettered by the word of God, by believing God's word is God's best for your life. So let's just pray together. Say, Jesus, help me to believe your word. Help me to receive your best. Help me to accept the truth. Right now, it may seem like it offends me, but I know that you love me. Come on, say it with me. I know that you love me, Jesus. And I ask you to open my heart. I believe you died on the cross for me. Come on, say it. I believe you died on the cross for me. And I believe that that brought me forgiveness, and I receive it. And you rose from the dead for your spirit to give me truth and strength to walk in your will. Amen and amen. God bless you. Talk to you soon.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's rule as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He hears faith.
Worship him.